The class 12 physics syllabus consists of three major branches of physics: electromagnetism, optics, and modern physics. Electromagnetism completely occupies the first volume of NCERT textbook. Electromagnetism is further subdivided into two parts: electrostatics and electrodynamics. The first two chapters of your book make electrostatics, and the next six chapters are electrodynamics. Since the entire electrostatics has been packed inside only two chapters, so these chapters are bigger in size as compared to the other chapters. They have to be big, so they take longer time to finish, so you have to be patient. Besides, these chapters are the fundamentals of electromagnetism. We will begin with very basic concept, very basic idea of electromagnetism. You have to pay close attention to the concepts discussed in the chapters. So let's start electrostatics, and I will start with the definition of electrostatics. You see, electrostatics is actually the combination of two words, electro and static. The word electro refers to electricity, and static means at rest. So electrostatics is basically the study of charges at rest. Okay? Study of charges at rest. The charge at rest produces some phenomena which we are going to study in this chapter. Basically, we are concerned with two quantities, two physical quantities. One is electric field and other is electric potential. So we have to deal in great details about these phenomena regarding the electric charge at rest. Okay? So electrostatics is the study of electric charges at rest and electric field potential due to the charges at rest. So if you want to write the definition of electrostatics, you can write down: electrostatics is the branch of physics which deals with the study of charges at rest. So let's start the first chapter. This is the definition of electrostatics. In electrostatics, in your book, you have to study two chapters. The first one, chapter one, is electric charges and fields. So this chapter is completely regarding the electric fields, all the properties and phenomena related to electric fields. And the next chapter is electrostatic potentials and capacitance. That chapter will deal with the electric potential and capacitors. So I'm going to start chapter one, which is electric charges and fields. This is chapter one. Okay, chapter one, electric charges and fields. So the discussion of this chapter begins with the most important concept here, most important entity, which is going to control everything, because without charge, there cannot be any electricity or electromagnetism. So we will start with the definition of charge. What is charge? So let us begin with the definition of charge. Charge is a physical quantity, and it is represented by capital Q or small q. You can use any one of these symbols to represent the charge. Now, let us talk about the definition of charge. If you want to understand the definition of charge, you must first recall the definition of mass. In class 11, you have already studied about mass, and you have got the definitions of mass. There are two definitions. The first definition you study in the chapter Laws of Motion. And in that chapter, you study that mass is the measure of inertia. But this definition is only related to laws of motion, nothing fundamental here. In gravitation chapter, you get another definition of mass. And it says, mass is the intrinsic property of matter due to which it exerts or experiences gravitational forces. In the same manner, charge is another intrinsic property. And this property is responsible for another type of fundamental force. You know, gravitational force is a fundamental force. Electromagnetic force is a fundamental force in nature. So charge is another intrinsic property which is responsible for another fundamental force in nature. And that force is electromagnetic force. Without charge, there will be no electric force, no magnetic force, no electromagnetism. Actually, matter has got three intrinsic properties. The fundamental particles have three intrinsic properties. By intrinsic property, I mean that when they come in existence, they come with certain property in them, inherent property in them. They get those property by birth. Okay? We as a human being have got some properties by birth. We have one nose, two eyes, two ears. These are the properties which have got by birth, which we have got by birth. So these are the inherent property of us. In the same manner, matter comes with three inherent properties. Okay? I'm going to write these intrinsic properties of matter first of all, then I will come to charge. Intrinsic properties of matter. The first one is mass, the second one is charge, and the third one is spin. These three intrinsic properties are responsible for all the fundamental forces. There are four types of fundamental forces in nature. And these fundamental forces are produced, are due to these intrinsic properties. One property is responsible for one type of force. For example, mass is responsible for gravitational force. There will be no gravity without mass. Charge is responsible for electromagnetic force. And spin is responsible for all the nuclear forces, strong nuclear force and weak nuclear force. Okay? So every intrinsic property is linked with a fundamental force. So we can use the fundamental force to define these intrinsic properties. So charge is the intrinsic property of matter due to which it exerts or experiences electromagnetic forces. It is the intrinsic property of matter due to which it exerts or experiences electromagnetic forces. Okay? So charge is the intrinsic property of matter due to which it exerts or experiences electromagnetic forces. Okay? Now we will see the SI unit of charge. You know, SI unit of charge is coulomb. So we will talk about the unit of charge. Of charge is coulomb. You can write down this in your notes, in your notebook. Whenever you want to note down anything, you can just pause the video and write down in your notebook. On a practical scale, coulomb is a very big unit. So practically, you will find in numerical problems the submultiples of coulomb, like microcoulomb, nanocoulomb, millicoulomb. You must know the meaning of the symbols used there, prefixes used there. Okay? Coulomb is very big unit. It is so big that if one coulomb of charge is passed through our body in 1 second, then it can kill us 1000 times if that has been passed by an alternating current. Why I am saying that? Because our body is an electrical instrument, and every electrical instrument has got a current rating. It is the maximum current that instrument can tolerate without being damaged. So the current rating of our body is 1 milliampere. If one coulomb of charge has been passed through our body, by an alternating current in 1 second, it will produce a current of 1 ampere, which is 1000 times of our current rating, which is 1 milliampere. So 1 coulomb is a very big amount of charge. Submultiples of coulomb, let us see some of the submultiples here. 1 micro coulomb is 1 submultiple. Micro means 10 to the power minus 6. So it is actually 10 to the power minus 6 coulomb. 1 milli coulomb, you see the difference in the symbols of the prefixes. Milli is represented by small m and micro is represented by mu. So 1 milli coulomb is 10 to the power minus 3 coulomb. 1 nano coulomb is 10 to the power minus 9 coulomb. You can have pico coulomb. 1 pico coulomb is 10 to the power minus 12 coulomb. Okay. These are some submultiples of coulomb which you will see in numerical problems. Microcoulomb is most common of them. You know there are two types of charges, negative and positive. The charge on an electron is a negative charge. The charge on a proton is a positive charge. Practically, the charges on all the bodies which we see in our day-to-day life are due to these two particles, either electron or proton. At the atomic scale, when we are dealing with the charges on subatomic particles like electron, proton, neutron, alpha particle, in that situation also coulomb is too big to handle. In that situation, we use the magnitude of charge on an electron as a unit and we call it basic electronic charge. The value of basic electronic charge is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. You have to remember this, you have to memorize it and you will need to recall. You will need to recall it whenever necessary. So E is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Charge on an electron is minus E and charge on a proton is plus E. And this is also the smallest possible value of charge which we can discover independently. There are charges which are in the fractions of E, charge on a quark, but those charges do not exist independently. Quark does not exist outside the proton. So the smallest charge which we can discover is a charge on an electron or charge on a proton. In proton it will come with positive sign, in electron it will come with negative sign, but the magnitude is this, 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. We call it basic electronic charge, okay, E. We also, at the atomic scale, we also use the different unit of mass and we call it atomic mass unit. You know this from the chemistry. In chemistry, you must have studied about the atomic mass unit in class 11. So I'm going to recall that for you. Atomic mass unit is the unit of mass which we use at the atomic scale. Atomic mass unit. In physics, the symbol U is used to represent atomic mass unit. So 1 U is actually the mass of a proton. The mass of a proton and neutron are equal and we use this mass as a unit at the atomic scale. We use it to express the masses of some subatomic particles. So basic electronic charge, you can write down this. Now I'm going to discuss the charge in mass values of some subatomic particles. These values we may need, or you must be aware of these values because these particles will come in numerical problems. So you must know the mass and charge of these particles. So one by one I'm going to write down here the mass and charge of certain subatomic particles. Some of them are known to you, some of them may not be known to you. So let's see. The first one is electron. Let's begin with electron. The charge on an electron is minus E. Charge on the electron is negative and the magnitude is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. So charge on an electron is minus E. The mass of the electron, it cannot be expressed. It can be expressed in U, but it's much smaller than U. So we don't use the unit U here. Mass of the electron is 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kilograms. Now, another particle is positron. Positron. I'm not saying proton, it's positron. So, what is a positron? Actually, positron is the antiparticle. Positron is the antiparticle of electron. Antiparticles of electrons. Positrons are the antiparticles of electrons. So first of all, you must know the concept of antiparticle. In particle physics, every particle has got its antiparticle. If you have two particles of equal masses and their charges are opposite, then they will be said to be antiparticles of each other. And for neutral particles, their spins should be opposite. That means if we have a pair of particles of equal masses and they have opposite charges or opposite spin, if they are neutral, then these two particles are antiparticles of each other. So the antiparticle of electron is positron. Now you can guess the mass and charge of it. The mass of positron will be same as the mass of electron, but the charge will be just opposite of the charge on the electron. Proton is not the antiparticle of electron because the mass of proton is much higher than the mass of electron. They are not equal. Proton also has got its antiparticle. A particle with mass same as the mass of proton and charge is just opposite, charge is minus E. That particle is called antiproton. And you can form an atom by placing an antiproton in the nucleus and positron in the orbit. Such atom also exists in nature. And this atom is called anti-hydrogen atom. In the same manner, anti-helium atom can exist. Anti-lithium atom can exist. And if you make matter, if the matter is made up of these anti-atoms, that will be called antimatter. But in nature, antimatter are not in abundance. Antiparticles are not in abundance. Electron, we can see lot of electron in the nature. Universe has produced electrons in abundance, but there are no positrons in abundance. Why the nature is favoring particles, matter, not antimatter? We don't know the reason behind it, because the logic of symmetry says that these two particles should be in equal quantities. Why the nature is biased here, we don't know. Anyway, so I was talking about the antiparticle. So positron is the antiparticle of electron, and with the idea, with the concept of it, with the concept of antiparticle, you can now easily write the mass and charge. You can easily recall the mass and charge of positron. So I'm going to write that. Charge on the positron will be plus E, and the mass of the positron will be same as the mass of the electron. 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kilograms. Okay. You can write down these numbers. The next particle which I am going to discuss is proton. If you know the mass and charge of proton, you can just skip this part. Proton. Proton is the nucleus of protium. Nucleus of protium. You know, hydrogen atom has got three isotopes. Protium, deuterium and tritium. The mass number of protium is 1, mass number of deuterium is 2, and the mass number of tritium is 3. The nucleus of protium has got only one proton, and that is all there. Nucleus of deuterium has got two particles, one proton and one neutron. And the nucleus of tritium has got three particles, one proton and two neutrons. So, proton is the nucleus of protium because protium is H11 isotope of hydrogen atom. So, if you remove the electron from the orbit, the only thing you will be left with is the proton. So, in chemistry, you will see proton is shown as H+. Okay? In nuclear physics, we show proton by H11. Now, the mass and charge. The charge on the proton is plus C and the mass of the proton is 1 U. Okay? I'm going to discuss two more particles. The next one is deuteron. Deuteron is the nucleus of deuterium. Now, the nucleus of deuterium consists of two particles, one proton and one neutron. Neutron is neutral, so all the charge it will have, it will be only due to proton. So charge on it will be plus C, but it has got two particles and both of them have the mass 1 amu. So for the two particle, it will be 2 amu. So the mass is 2 U, charge is plus C. Deuteron. Now the next particle which I am going to discuss is alpha particle. It is the nucleus of helium atom. Actually, it is the nucleus of helium-4, which is the most common isotope, most abundant isotope of helium. Now, the nucleus of helium atom has four particles, two proton and two neutron. So mass will be 4 times of 1 amu because each of the particle has the mass 1 amu. But only two particles are charged here, two protons. So charge will be twice of the charge on the proton. So charge on the alpha particle is plus 2e, mass of the alpha particle will be 4u, okay? So these are the charge and mass values of some subatomic particles. So we have done some fundamental concepts here. Now I'm going to start few more concepts. I'm going to discuss few more basic concepts. The first one is work function. So let us see what is work function. Before entering into work function, I would like to discuss some concepts of energy of a bound system. What keeps a system bound? Suppose you have a system of 2 particle, 3 particle. What keeps them bound? They form a bound system. Why do they form a bound system? And if you want to remove a particle from that system, or if a particle wants to escape from that system, what will be the condition for that escape? Okay. The most common example of bound system is we and Earth. We are all bound to Earth, or any object which lives on the surface of Earth is bound to Earth surface. If that object, why don't that object leave the Earth surface and go into the space? There is some barrier. So I'm going to talk about that barrier. Actually, that barrier is of potential energy. So let us see the potential energy of an object placed on Earth. If you have Earth here, this is the Earth. And suppose we have a ball here. The mass of the ball is M. Center O, radius is R, the mass of Earth is capital M. Its potential energy is given by U equal to minus G mm by R. You see, this potential energy is negative. We assume the potential energy at infinity to be zero. If you assume potential energy at infinity to be zero, which is a common convention in case of two particle system, then its potential energy at this stage is minus G mm by R, which is a negative potential energy. Its kinetic energy is zero. Kinetic energy is zero. So the total energy is U plus K, which is minus G mm by R. Okay? Its total energy is negative. Suppose you throw this particle in upward direction. If you throw this particle with some speed V, it will gain some kinetic energy. But when it will move in upward direction or move away from Earth, its potential energy will increase. And potential energy will increase at the cost of kinetic energy. Kinetic energy will decrease, so its speed will decrease. And a point will come when kinetic energy will become zero. If the kinetic energy becomes zero before reaching to the infinity or before going out of the Earth's gravitational field, the particle will fall back on the Earth. If you have to throw this particle out of Earth's gravitational field, then we will have to give so much kinetic energy, so much speed to the particle, so that its kinetic energy becomes zero at infinity or beyond. Okay? And that energy can be given to it in the form of kinetic energy. We can just make a calculation of that energy. If you see, total energy is negative. As long as total energy is negative, its kinetic energy will become zero before reaching to the infinity. What if you make this energy positive? Suppose you give some kinetic energy to this particle, you give some speed V in any direction, okay? Now, its kinetic energy is half mv square, okay? Now, if this half mv square is greater than equal to G mm by R. I have removed the minus sign. If this half mv square will be equal to G mm by R, you add this kinetic energy K in the minus G mm by R, total energy will be zero. That will be the minimum criteria to cross to escape from Earth's gravitation. And if half mv square is greater than G mm by R, then its total energy will be positive, and it will escape from Earth's gravitation with some additional kinetic energy. It will spend G mm by R amount of energy in escape, and after that, when it comes out of the Earth's gravitation, it will have some kinetic energy left with it. So you have to remember here two points. If a system consisting of more than one particle has total energy to be negative, if its total energy is negative, the system will remain bound as a bound system. If a particle has to escape from that bound system, in that situation, the particle must have so much kinetic energy that its total energy, the sum of kinetic plus potential energy, becomes positive or zero. The minimum energy which is required, minimum kinetic energy, if you give this much amount of energy, G mm by R, it will escape. And the speed corresponding to this kinetic energy is called the escape velocity or escape speed. You have studied about this in class 11. Now let us apply this concept to atom in electrostatic situation. In atom, there is a nucleus, and nucleus has a positive charge, and there is electron revolving around the nucleus. Let us consider the simplest atom, hydrogen atom. If you see the energy here again, the nucleus has a positive charge plus C, and in the orbit there is an electron revolving electron revolving in the orbit, and this is the velocity, mass. Its potential energy, you just accept it right now because we will derive the expression of potential energy in the next chapter. Okay, its potential energy right now is minus E square by 4 pi epsilon naught r, and its kinetic energy is half mv square. Okay, as long as this kinetic energy is less than mod of u, the total energy will be negative. Okay, because negative number is higher, negative value is higher than the positive value. So if you add them, you will get a negative number. And as long as you get a negative number, electron will remain bound to the nucleus. If you see in this situation, the total energy U plus K is actually minus E, U plus K is actually negative. Negative. Okay? And whatever negative value the energy has, if you give it this much amount of kinetic energy, the kinetic energy equal to mod of E, if you give this extra amount of kinetic energy to the electron, okay, then its total energy will become zero. In that situation, electron will manage to escape. Okay, so the minimum energy required for the escape of this electron from here is mod of E, and E will have some negative value which will be given by U plus K. So any system which has total negative energy comes because of the potential energy, any system which has total negative energy, and if you provide it some positive energy, if you provide it some kinetic energy to any particle, so that its total energy becomes positive or zero, then that particle will escape from that system. Okay, now let us apply this to a solid body, a piece. Suppose we have a solid piece of material, we have a solid body here, suppose solid body. Okay, now this body will have so many atoms, molecules, depending on the structure of this solid. The thing is, this solid piece will have atoms, and atom will have electrons. Okay, there are some electrons which has very high kinetic energy in the surface layer, and they have so much kinetic energy that they break out of the bond and they start moving. So these electrons have some kinetic energy. If you consider the total energy of electron plus solid body system, suppose one electron escapes from here. If one electron escapes from here, suppose one electron gets some amount of kinetic energy from somewhere, then it will break out of the bonded pair, break out of the bonding. It will leave the bonded pair and it will start moving, first inside this lattice, inside the solid material, and then if that electron tries to escape from the surface, then what will happen? Let us see. Suppose if this electron is moving in this direction, when the electron will leave the surface layer, it will have an electron deficiency. Now the solid piece is positively charged. Okay, any body is neutral because total number of proton and total number of electrons are equal in that body, so that the charges cancel each other, so body is neutral. So this solid piece was neutral because all the electrons were inside the solid. If any one electron leaves the solid, there will be an imbalance in the number of electron and proton. It will have one excess proton, so it will be positively charged. Now this positive charge will attract this negative charge, so this electron will slow down and its speed will decrease, and a time will come when its speed will become zero, it will fall back. It is the similar situation. If this electron has to escape from here, the electron will have to move to the infinity, move outside the electric field of this solid piece. And here also, if you see the energy of this electron in the surface, okay, if you consider the energy of this electron inside the surface, in the surface layer, if we pull out one electron, then, or if you exclude the charge of electron, suppose you consider this electron as one particle and rest of the material as another particle of the system, okay, so its potential energy will be something negative, its potential energy will be negative. You see, the formula for potential energy of two charged particles is Q1 Q2 by 4 pi epsilon naught r. It is just a rough estimate. If one charge is positive, another charge is negative, then the product will be negative and potential energy will be negative. So here, if we consider electron as another separate entity and rest of the solid body as a separate particle, another particle, then the rest of the body is positive and electron is negative. So the product is negative, so its total potential energy, its potential energy will be negative. And kinetic energy, if the electron has got certain amount of kinetic energy due to by some external means, kinetic energy is positive. But if the sum U plus K, suppose U plus K is less than zero, then electron will remain bound to the surface. Even if the electron gets some energy, if that kinetic energy is insufficient, as long as this kinetic energy is less than mod of U, okay, its kinetic energy is less than mod of U, it will not be able to escape because total energy will be negative. Now let us see the condition for escape. Suppose its total energy is K plus U, and suppose it is minus phi naught, total energy. Now my question is, how much energy you should add to the electron so that its total energy becomes zero? Definitely it is plus phi naught. If you provide plus phi naught amount of energy to the electron as a kinetic energy, then its total energy will become positive. It will manage to escape. If you provide kinetic energy greater than phi naught, it will again escape, and after the escape, it will have some kinetic energy left with it, some leftover kinetic energy. But if energy provided to the electron is less than phi naught, then it will never manage to escape. So phi naught here is the minimum amount of energy required to be given to the electron so that it escapes from this surface of this body. And this minimum amount of energy is called work function. Different body has different work function. If a body is holding electron very tightly, then its potential energy will be more negative. So more energy will be required to be given to the electron for the escape. But if a body is holding the electron loosely in the surface, then less energy will be required to be given for the escape of electron. So different body has different work function that depend on their molecular structures. Write down the definition of work function. The minimum amount of energy required to remove an electron from the surface of a body is called its work function. Okay? The minimum amount of energy required to remove an electron from the surface of a body is called its work function. Okay? So, enough for today.